So let me consider a mass M being connected with the spring of spring tension K. So this system, when it is being displaced by a distance of x, it can act as what is called as a linear harmonic oscillator. It can move here and there about a mean position. So the force acting on the particle is given by Fe equal to minus K into x, where x is called as the displacement of the particle that execute this simple harmonic motion. F is the force acting on a particle. Suppose if we draw a curve as to find out this variation of this force with respect to displacement, when we take this displacement along x-axis and the force along the y-axis, the curve we have is in this way, goes this way. So F equal to minus kx. So I can make this as m into a, that is equal to minus k into x. So acceleration of the particle that perform a displacement of x is given by minus k by m into x. So I can identify this as simple harmonic motion, since this acceleration is directly proportional to the displacement. Then I can call this equation for this simple harmonic motion as A equal to omega square into x. So comparing these two equations, I can get omega square as k by m. From this, I can find out this angular frequency as well as the period of oscillation. Now, let me consider another system. Here is a mass of m being connected by two springs, as I have shown on the board. Let us assume that k1 and k2 are the spring constant. Therefore, the total force acting on the system is given by Fe equal to F1 plus F2. So, I can write the total force acting on the system as M into A, that is equal to. So, I can have this F1. F1 can be written as, for the first spring, it is of minus K1 into X. For the second spring, it is of minus k2 into x. Therefore, the equation turns out to be ma equal to minus k1 plus k2 into x. So, the expression for acceleration turns out to be minus k1 plus k2 by m into x. So, I can say have this as the expression for this acceleration acting on the particle. Now we can call up this general equation for simple harmonic motion, A equal to minus omega square x. From this, I can see this omega square is nothing but omega square equal to k1 plus k2 by m. So from this, we can have this omega as square root of k1 plus k2 by m. Suppose one of the spring is absent, the resulting expression does not have the spring constant associated with this. For example, if first spring, that is of spring constant k1, is cut off, the resulting expression becomes omega equal to root of k2 by m. On the other hand, suppose there is no spring of spring constant of the spring with spring constant of k2, so it does not have, it does not be there. As a result, the expression for omega is root of k1 by m. So let me consider a system of mass m connected by two springs, one of spring constant k1 and another is of spring constant k2. The force acting on both the springs is the same. Therefore, I can write this F as F equal to minus k1 by k1 x1, and the force acting on the spring of spring constant k2 as Fe equal to minus k2 x2. So the total displacement made by the particle is given by Xe equal to x1 plus x2. So the total displacement x is given by F by Ks, that is equal to x1 can be written as F by k1 and x2 can be written as F plus F by k2. So on cancelling the force, I can have this expression as 1 by ks that is equal to 1 by k1 plus 1 by k2. So this is an expression for two springs while they have been connected in series. Now let us come back to two springs connected in parallel. Here the total force acting on them can be written as F equal to F1 plus F2. So the total, the effective spring constant is given by Kp. So let us assume that the same displacement has been undergone. Therefore, K1 into X plus K2 into X. Because both springs undergoes the same displacement. As a result, the final expression can be written as Kp equal to K1 plus K2. So whenever we have two springs which are connected in parallel, the resultant expression for the spring constant is given by Kp equal to K1 plus K2. So in the above diagram, there are four springs of spring constant K1, K2, K3 and K4. So we can identify this K1 and K2 are parallel to each other, and K3 and K4 also parallel to each other. And this parallel combination of this K1 and K2 is in series with the parallel combination of K3 and K4. So let us solve this first as this K parallel 1. That can be written as K1 plus K2. At the parallel combination of K3 and K4 have an effective spring constant of Kp2 equal to K3 plus K4. Suppose the spring constants are equal. Suppose K1 equal to K2 equal to K3 equal to K4. So one K1 equal to K2 that is equal to K3 that is equal to K4. Then Kp1 can be written as 2k, and Kp2 also it's of 2k. This Kp1 and Kp2 are in series with each other. So Kp1 is in series with each other with Kp2. So the effective spring constant, since they are being in series, is can be written as 1 by Ks that is equal to 1 by Kp1 plus 1 by Kp2. So we know the value of Kp1 as 2k and Kp2 also 2k. So I can write 1 by Ks equal to 1 by 2k plus 1 by 2k. As a result, 1 by Ks equal to 2k. So Ks equal to k. So this is the way we have to find out the effective spring constant while the springs are connected in series as well as in parallel. So let me consider a system of simple pendulum of length m. Let m is the mass of the pendulum. So the downward force acting on the system is m into g, and theta is the angle made by this pendulum about the mean position, vertical position. Therefore, the torque about the mean support, about the support, can be written as, so this is a force, restoring force acting on it. Let through a displacement of L, I can have this torque as tau equal to minus mg sin theta into L. From Newton's law of rotational motion, so I can have this torque as I into alpha. So let me consider this as equation 1 and the other as equation 2. Equating these two, what I get is alpha I alpha equal to mg sin theta into L. For small oscillation, the sin theta goes to be theta. Therefore, small oscillations sine theta equal to theta. Therefore, the resulting expression becomes I alpha equal to mg theta into L. So from this equation, I can see I have this alpha equal to mg L theta by I. So definitely this angular displacement, angular acceleration is directly proportional to this angular displacement. So the resultant thing is a simple harmonic motion. So we can call back our equation of simple harmonic motion, that is alpha equal to omega square into theta. From these two equations, we can identify this omega square as mgl by I. From this, we can have this omega as square root of m into g into l by I. So it's a very important expression as to solve problem, where I is what is called as the moment of inertia, l is the length of the simple pendulum. Omega equal to root of mgl by I. So omega can be written as 2 pi by t, that is equal to root of mgl by I. So period of oscillation can be written as 2 pi into root of I into mgl. So the moment of inertia of a body about an axis can be written as m into L square. Therefore, the period of oscillation goes to be 2 pi into root of L by g. So this expression helps us to solve many problems that occurred in our practical life. Now let us assume that the same pendulum has been fixed in a moving bus or a moving vehicle. So that it is being accelerated with an acceleration A. So G is the acceleration here. Now there are two acceleration, one is horizontal direction and another one is the vertical direction. So you have to find out the resultant one. So which can be written as square root of A square plus G square, because they are perpendicular to each other. So this is the resultant acceleration acting on this system. Therefore, the period of oscillation can be written as T equal to 2 pi into root of L by square root of A square plus G square. T1 is the period of oscillation of a simple pendulum on the surface of a earth, and T2 is the period of oscillation at a height of r meter from the surface of the earth, where r is called as the radius of the earth. So we can compare the ratio of this T1 and T2. So period of oscillation is related to this acceleration due to gravity as T equal to 2 pi into square root of L by G. G is related to this radius of the earth by G is inversely proportional to R square. Therefore, I can have this G prime by G, that is equal to R square by R plus H the whole square, where G prime is the acceleration due to gravity at a height of r meter from the surface of the earth. G is the acceleration due to gravity at the surface of the earth. So we have assumed this H equal to r. Therefore, G prime by G equal to r square by 4r square. That is G prime by G equal to 1 by 4. So G prime equal to G by 4. Since the period of oscillation is inversely proportional to this acceleration due to gravity, I can write T1 by T2 equal to root of G prime by G. So T1 by T2 equal to G by 4 by G square. Therefore, T1 by T2 that is equal to 1 by 2. So let me keep a simple pendulum in a lift that is being accelerated upward with an acceleration A equal to G by 4. Therefore, the period, what I want to see, what happens to the period of oscillation of the simple pendulum that is being kept in a lift that is being accelerated upward with an acceleration A equal to G by 4. The period of oscillation we know of a simple pendulum is given by T equal to 2 pi into square root of L by G. So the resultant acceleration G prime equal to G plus A. Because when a lift is accelerating upward, the resultant acceleration goes to be G plus A. Therefore, the period of oscillation T prime becomes 2 pi into root of L by G prime. So in the place of this G prime, we need to make a substitution for this A. As a result, T prime equal to 2 pi into root of L by 5G by 4. Therefore, T prime equal to 2 pi into root of L by G into 2 pi root 5. So, T prime equal to 2 by root 5 into T. In the case of damped oscillation, the displacement made by the particle y of t equal to a into exponential of minus bt by 2m into cos of omega prime t plus pi, where omega prime equal to square root of k by m minus b square by 4m square. The amplitude is a into exponential of minus bt by 2m. Let's illustrate a simple problem as to explain this damped harmonic oscillation. So I have a damped harmonic oscillator. I wish to find how much is the time taken by this oscillator to reduce its amplitude to one half of its original value. So I know the amplitude of a damped harmonic oscillator as A prime equal to A into exponential of minus BT by 2M. So I wish to find how much is the time taken by the amplitude to get reduced by 1 half. So in the place of A prime, I can substitute A by 2. A by 2 equal to A into exponential of minus B into the time taken, the amplitude to reduce 1 by of its original value has been taken by me as t of s. Therefore, half equal to exponential of minus b t of by 2m. So, taking logarithm on both sides, what I have is ln 2 equal to minus of b t of by 2m. So, T of equal to ln 2 by B by 2m. So, since we know the value of B as well as mass, we can find how much is the time taken by this damped oscillator to reduce its amplitude to one of its original value. So far we have discussed about this oscillation and of its effects over spring. So far we discussed about this oscillation. Let us apply this oscillation in our next video, that is wave motion. Thank you.